I think, can you all see this? Were you okay with, looks like, what'd you do, Bernard, you squared that?
Yeah.
And then that T by itself, and then substituted that into the other equation, foiled it out, collected like terms, and that's what you came up with, right? Now, I want to talk about this one for just a second, because if we look, okay, so in Sir's problem, in Sir's problem, there was absolutely nothing wrong with any T value that you wanted. Now, he was told specifically to use a couple of different T values, but if left on your own, you could use whatever T you wanted on this problem, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. This is a little bit different. Would you agree?
Mm-hmm.
I can't really use any T value that I want. Because why? What's going to happen right there? We're going to have an issue, aren't we? So we're going to have to understand that for this system of parametric equations, T has to be bigger than or equal to negative 1. Would you agree with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So what does that mean for X? If T has to be bigger than or equal to negative 1, then what's going to happen to my X value? It's going to be bigger than or equal to 0. So when I do this conversion and I write my equation in terms of just X's and Y's, I better note that my domain for this new equation that I just wrote, my domain is what? Everything from 0 to infinity. Okay, does that make sense to you? That your X's, which ultimately are going to become your domain, are dependent on the T value you pick. And since T is restricted, then X is going to be restricted. And when your domain is restricted, you need to know this. Okay. All right. Good. Good work. Okay. Now that one down there, I don't know, I have a little question about it. And I don't know if it's just me or if somebody else has a question about it. Does anybody have anything any different for that last problem on this front page? Oh good, so some of the others are the two. Let's sort it out here. So here's my original problem. By the way, just for fun, not necessary, but just for fun, what's the domain of this original? This is the original problem. What's the domain? Can't be 0, right? So I'll write it out longhand. Basically, we're saying X can't be 0. But if we write it out formally, it looks like this. Okay, what's about the range? No, 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 be careful. We have a horizontal asymptote there, don't we? So basically, Y can't be negative 4/3. So that's my range, or my original.
I have a question about the last problem.
Oh,
wouldn't
yep.
that be negative 1 on the domain? Because it's T plus 1 under the radical. So if it was negative 1, you'd still have 0.
Well, you're allowed to have 0 under a radical.
I know, but if you put 0, like if you put negative 1, you would still end up with 0 under the radical. Would it be bracket negative 1?
No, I'm not. These are X values.
Mm-hmm.
T values.
Oh.
These are T values. Okay, that would be negative 1.
Oh.
Does that make sense to you?
I think so.
Okay. What was it? X equals what? Square root of T plus 1. Can you let X be negative 1?
Oh.
This is X. These are X values right here.
Okay.
Can X be negative 1? No. So you're getting your X's and your T's mixed up. All right, now let's find the inverse, because I think that's where we went awry down there. Let's see. So X equals 4Y minus 1 over negative 3Y. So are you watching this? So negative three X Y equals four Y minus one. I'll put all the X's to all the Y's on the same side. Factor them out. And divide. I'm just gonna go ahead and get rid of those negatives. Now that's what I got for my inverse. Does anybody match that?
Yeah.
Yes.
So this is the inverse right here.
So logic is, because this is completely different, like the logic works.
Because the logic only works, if you're saying just like, here's the function, now undo it.
Yeah.
It only works if it's a continuous movement. When you have something like this, it's not.
So you have to
x plus 7 over 5. You're going to add 7 and divide by 5. Okay? On this one, you're going to times by 4, subtract 1.
Yep.
Then you're going to times by 3, and then you're going to divide.
Yeah.
So it's broken in there. You have to do an operation before you divide by that. Yeah. Now, what I don't know is. Yeah, I think whenever you have an X in the denominator, I don't think you're going to be able to do it intuitively. I'm going to have to write it out. Okay, now, what's the domain of the inverse? Well, you can tell, but you can also tell from what we wrote up here. Because when we find the domain of the inverse, it's going to be the range of the original. So this is the domain of the inverse. And this is the range. Remember, they switch. Okay, this has an asymptote at 0, a horizontal asymptote at 0, and obviously x is going to be negative 4 thirds. So that's another way to check your answers, guys. Remember that the domain and range of whatever you get as your answer have to be the reverse of what we started with. Alright, are we good with these three? Alright, let's go on the back side. Let's do number 4 out loud. Tell me what transformations happen. We went left 4 and down 2. Hopefully that's what y'all wrote. And then what about B? What happened there? We reflected across the x-axis, flipped upside down, and then went up 1. Now what about number 5? Anybody have a good graph for that that you're willing to share? Want to come put it up here, sir, so we can all look at it. Try to do it carefully so you can kind of see what the points are. Okay, so this problem that Sir is drawing, it's an absolute value B, obviously. Why is it upside down? Because of the negative, right? And his vertex is right 2 up 1, is that correct? And then he has a vertical stretch going on here. His slope is 3. So in a normal curve, we would go over 1 up 1, right? I mean, that's normal. But because we times by 3, our y's We're still going over one, but now we're going down three. So it's skinnier, it's stretched because of the out in front. Is that all right with everybody? All right, let's put a pause on that. I know there's more, hang on to the paper. We will do more, I promise. But let's do look at our review sheet because that was your assignment last night to go home and find some review work that we needed to do. Oh, Meredith's seen your ponytails. I used to have long hair. And I wore it in Maria's like that all growing up. We lived out on a farm. My parents still live there. And we burned our trash. And so, you know, when it's time to burn the trash, you go out, put it in a barrel, lean over, and you light it. And one day it vibrated, caught fire.
Yep.
And, yeah, that was an interesting look there.
That story is hilarious.
No, it wasn't hilarious. And I don't know if you've ever smelled burning human hair.
It's disgusting.
It is a terrible smell. So anyway, yeah, it worked out awesome.
At least you didn't have hairspray on, did you? Did you have hairspray on?
No, I agree.
Okay, that's a good thing.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess I could have gone up in flames.
Yeah.
Very flammable.
All right. Anybody have anything you found as you did this review sheet, as you looked it over? And remember, I don't collect review work. You do review work if you want to do well. It's all I need to do it.
This is kind of an easy one, like number 13.
13. Let's look at 13. So, 13 says. We have 3 plus cosine. Now, it is important that you graph your cosine, or at least understand the graph of the cosine carefully. The cosine oscillates back and forth between 1 and negative 1, right? Just like the sine does. So when we add 3 to that, so this is 1, this is negative 1. So when we add 3 to that, that is, move every point up 3, what's going to happen? Whatever happened at 1 is now going to happen at
4.
And whatever happened at negative 1 is now going to happen at 2. So now you're going to have your cosine. I mean, you didn't have to graph it, but this is what it would look like, right? So it says, what are the upper and lower bounds? Well, the lower bound is
2,
and the upper bound is 4. So that would be considered a bounded function because it has both an upper bound and a lower bound. Is that okay with everybody? Mm-hmm. Ellen?
How did you know where to
What do you mean?
Plus
3? Remember, that's a vertical shift when you tack a plus something on the end of the problem. This is the same as cosine x plus 3. So that moves it up. Okay? Yes? This is the review sheet. It is on Schoology. This is the review sheet. I don't know, chapter 1 review. Now, are you guys asking questions about this problem?
Yes.
Okay.
So how would you, like, what would it look like to stretch or shrink that? Would it just be solving for x?
You mean sideways?
Yeah. Like,
okay. Now, we're not doing that right now because I know this. I don't have any labels on my x-axis.
Right.
But that would be just like usual. You would have something like this. Because these labels, these are degrees or radians, usually radians. So this would be like pi over two, pi, three pi over two, and two pi.
Okay.
And likewise back this way. So yeah, you would just pick it up, and in that case, I would shift it. So then instead of starting here, it would start here.
Okay.
Now, interestingly enough, sir, now that you've mentioned it, if I did that, I would now have a negative sine curve. Now it's an upside down sine. See, going to the origin, it's an upside down sine.
Okay.
So there's actually a, what we call an identity that says that. We kind of just discovered it. But we're not shifting sideways because I haven't given you these labels yet.
Okay.
So, not shifting these sideways, obviously, yeah. These and these and things, yeah.
Well, because I was like wondering, like, if you like stretched it so much, like, it'll become like a line. No.
Oh, I see. Yeah, I haven't stretched and shrunk. I have translated. I can put a coefficient here to make the waves taller, and I can put a coefficient here to change the width of them, just like regular. We'll do a ton of that in chapter four.
Ooh.
Like anything else about this picture?
What for the A? Like X plus two or X plus two?
For the bounds?
Yeah.
Well, you put Y. Those are Y values. Those aren't X values. Okay? All right. What else? Who found something else? Good question there. Who found something else? Tommy?
Maybe number five.
Five? Okay, so phi, this says we have a couple random functions. And we want to find f of g of 2. So remember, when you do, it's called composition, when you do composition, literally f of g of 2. So I'm going to find g of 2 first. So g of 2 would be negative 1.
Yes.
And then I take my negative 1 and plug it into f. So f of negative 1 would be negative 4 times 1. So negative 4 is the answer. And then f of g of x is exactly the same thing, except we don't have a number. We're just going to do it in terms of the letter. So g of x is x minus 4 over 2. That is g of x. It says so right here. So for this problem, you are literally plugging g into f. So you will have negative 4 x minus 4 over 2 plus 2 squared. So you're literally taking the g function and plugging it into the f function in place of x.
Now, to get rid of that fraction, can you just multiply everything by 2 and it won't affect the exponent?
No.
Okay, it did take some.
No. So what we need to do here is get a common denominator. So that will be x minus 4 over 2 plus 4 over 2. What happens in here? Luckily, what happens? Yeah, these cancel, right?
Yeah.
So we just end up with negative 4 times x. Great. You know, last year, I taught Mr. Kennedy's room. I shared Mr. Kennedy's room.
Oh, and the buzzing?
Well, it was nonstop. But still there, I'm sure. We're in class. I'm up here at the board teaching away. And up through the floor, no joke, comes a bell. Happened in Mr. Strife's room too down there.
Oh no.
We go right up through the floor. Like this. Anyway, we survived.
Negative
So that's gonna be, isn't that just gonna be negative four x squared? I mean, negative x squared? Because it's negative four x squared over four, so it's just negative x squared. Tommy got it? All right, who else? What's another one that you found? With everything on this sheet, there's this one thing that's just perplexing you. Ellie?
Number 15.
15. Max drives on highway for 2 hours. He drives during this time, he averages 500. His average speed in the city. Okay. All right, so let's see. Anytime I'm driving down the highway, or I'm out on my daily walk, or I'm riding my bike, the little formula that's floating around in my head is, what do you know? Distance equals rate times time. That's exactly right. Distance equals rate times time. So what do we know? We know Max's time is 2 hours. We know his distance is 134. Can we figure out his rate? Sure. So his rate will be 67. Is that right? Hell, people, come on, this can't be that hard. Yeah, 67, right? That's out on the highway. He averages 32 miles an hour faster than he does in the city. So if this is his highway speed, what's his city speed?
35.
There's the answer to the question, right? Isn't that it? What's his average speed in the city? Now, there's a lot of words in that problem, but is it hard? No, don't let the words scare you. Don't let the words scare you. All right, what else have you found? What is it?
12.
12 feet. So let's see my original. My original has a point here. So here's my original. It's one more. One, two. So that looks like my original picture. All right, so what's happening in B? Let's make a list of how B is going to change, because there's a lot happening in that problem. So what's going on there? We're going to do what? We're going to go right, two,
and we're going to
go
multiply that two.
Upside down,
yeah.
Technically reflect across x-axis. And then we're going to be half as tall. So kind of in words, that's what's happening to the picture. So if you can handle all that at once, that's great. I can't. So I'm going to go ahead and take it right to. I'm going to take every one of those points and move them right to. So I'm hoping I got them plotted right when I did this. So right to, this is 1, 2, 3. Oh, wait. Did I say right to? Yep, right to. All right, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 1, 2, 3. All right, so going right to. Like that. Now, you might be able to do these two together. If you flip it over and go half as tall. So see how this point is down two? Now it's gonna be just up one. Does that make sense to you, Kristen? This point is down two. So he's gonna be up one now because he's flipped in half. And this one is gonna change. Because when you multiply zero by something, you're looking at y values now, it doesn't change. This one's up two, so he's gonna be down one. This one's up one, so he's gonna be down a half. This one was up six, so he's gonna be down.
That one's good.
It's 2-3. All right, Kirsten, that take care of it? Got it? Okay. Who else? Anybody else? Remember, when we prove they're inverses, we have to do a couple of compositions. So if we want to prove that these are inverses of each other, then we have to do this composition and this composition. And both of them should ultimately end up equaling x, because that's what I'm starting with. So if they're inverses, whatever I start with is what I'm ultimately going to end up with. Okay? So this says, this is like what we did before, plug g into f. So take g and plug it into f. So 3. 7x plus 2 over 3 minus 2 over 7. These are usually really easy to simplify. That looks like a mess, but can you see these 3s are going to cancel? And then the 2s will cancel, and then the 7s will cancel. So it ends up being exactly what we had hoped. This is the same thing, only now you're plugging this one into here. So you'll have 7, 3x minus 2 over 7, plugging into g, plus 2 over 3. The 7s will cancel, the 2s will cancel, and the 3s will cancel. So there you go. That's the proof.
Okay. And then we have to do it both ways. And like, do you want to see both
ways? That's the proof. Ellen, I'm just going to. Question about a couple of you were asking. Did you get all your homework issues straightened out? Any issues on homework? Yes, ma'am. Seven. Ruth is going to get a job, and they have made her two deals or two possibilities. So Ruth can get 25,000 plus 5% of the sales, or she can get 20,000 plus 7% of the sales. So you guys understand how it works for most salesmen. They work on what's called commission. So commission is the more you sell, the more you make, right? A percentage of your sales. So what they're telling this person is, okay, we can give you a base salary. So if you don't sell anything, we're gonna pay you $25,000 and then 5% of everything you sell. Or we'll give you a lower base salary and a higher percent of your sales. Now obviously the deal she takes should depend on how much she intends to sell, right? So if she sells nothing, then she wants to go with this route. So the question is, how much would she have to sell in order to make the second one more lucrative? So what's that X be? The amount she sells, right? That's what we're looking for. So 25,000 plus 0.05x, 5% of what she sells, is her salary with job A. 20,000 plus 7%x is her salary with job B. And we want the second one to be higher than the first one. So it's going to solve that little inequality. So in order for her to get ahead with her second possibility, she'll have to sell $250,000 worth of merchandise.
Which is not.
Depends what she's selling.
Oh, I thought she was a jeweler.
Oh, does it say that?
No, it doesn't. I just assumed.
But if she is a jeweler, that isn't that much.
No, cars not that much.
Candy bars, yeah.
Yeah.
Probably. Okay, is that all right with, you got it? All right. Anybody else have a homework question? Which one?
Six.
Six? Can I borrow this for a quick second? Six says, oh, we did this one already. This is like the one we did in our notes. It's exactly the same thing, except it looks like it might be a different size. So we're still putting the cylinder inside the parabola. This time, the parabola, I'm gonna pop this back on my axis system. And this time, the parabola has a 16-inch diameter, so this would be 16 comma something. It's a 32-inch diameter, so 16-inch radius. And it's 8 inches deep. And the cardboard cylinder has a radius of 8. And we want to know how tall the cylinder has to be.
So wouldn't that point be like X8?
This one? Well, the X value for both of these would be 8, right? And this one would be 8.8. Because it's up there on the level with that one.
Yeah.
This one, I don't know what it is.
Wait, why would it be that radius be something?
Didn't it say the radius was 8?
Yeah.
So this is 0.
Oh,
eight. Okay, so what's the equation of that parabola? I can write the equation of the parabola. It'll be y equals something, use whatever letter you want, x squared. The parabola opening up, vertex at the origin, right? So I don't know what that a is, but I know this point things on it. So 8 equals A times 16 squared. So I'm sure that reduces to something.
1 over 32.
1 over what?
32.
So the equation of my parabola is y equals 1/32 x squared. That's my parabola. Now, that point right there is on the parabola. Has an x value of 8. Yep, I need that point. So this is 2. Okay, that y is 2. This y is 8. I want to know how tall that cylinder is. So it's going from 2 to 8. So the height of the cylinder is 6 inches.
You put that point. Because you know that's 8.
Yeah. Anything else on homework or in that class back to homework here? Kids, I don't know if you pay any attention to your homework that I turned back, but you guys have a lot wrong. And you need to make sure you're figuring that out before test day. So don't just file the paper away. Take a look at it and see. Alright, so what we're going to do now is go ahead and go over our last quest. I'll turn these back to you.